the generations that of that age, you know, they didn't plan on living long.
Right.
You know, I mean, they said, boy, if I can get it to 62, I've got it made. Well, look where Social Security is, right?
Yeah. All right, Bud. You're wealthy, man.
I am. Yeah. Wealthy in so many ways, right?
Yeah.
Love of family, you know, secure, hopefully, in my financial future. You know, all the things you work for throughout your life.
You know, when we think about wealth, most people think wealth is all about money. It's how much money do you have? Look at how wealthy Warren Buffett is. Look at how wealthy Elon Musk is. Look at, all right. That's one definition, in my opinion, of wealth is how much money do you have?
Sure.
And what do you have to have in order to be considered wealthy from a financial perspective? Is somebody that has $100,000, are they wealthy? Is somebody that has $100 million, are they wealthy? What's the definition of wealthy?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, everybody will think dollars and cents, you know, associated with it, the accumulation of wealth that they've had over time. And certainly that's a component of all this, but I would hate to go through the rest of my life thinking that if I didn't have that, you know, that my life would be, you know, a very dismal situation from that perspective.
I will tell you this, Bud. My grandfather didn't have a lot of money, but he lived a very wealthy,
rich life,
a rich life. And why? Cause it was all about family for mm-hmm. him. It was about time with people that he loved and that he cared about. It wasn't about taking big trips. It wasn't about living in a big house. It wasn't about buying new cars. It wasn't about, it was to him, his wealth was all designed as time wealth, right?
Yeah.
Time with the people that he cared about.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he and my grandmother got to a point where they had to move in with my mom
right.
later in life. You know, from a financial perspective, they didn't do a really good job of saving enough. But of course, he never really earned a lot while he was younger either.
Yeah.
But to him, that wasn't the most important thing.
But the generations that of that age, you know, they didn't plan on living long.
Right.
You know, I mean, they said, boy, if I can get it to 62, I've got it made. Well, look where Social Security is, right?
Yeah.
And, you know, if you really got the chance to get Social Security, you should just stay alive just to be mean enough to get all your money back.
Well, you know, when Social Security originally came out, a little side tail here, but when Social Security was originally enacted,
Delano Roosevelt.
Right. Life expectancy was 62.
Yeah.
You
yeah.
know?
Right.
And so here now we are with average life expectancy in the early to mid 80s, but depending upon, you know, different factors, you know, your race, your gender, et cetera, will define what your life expectancy is on average. But people don't live to average life expectancy.
Yeah,
typically.
So I don't know for sure how long Social Security has been there since the 40s, I guess would be fair. And now you look at France and they're over there rioting because they moved their retirement age from 60 to 62, I believe, you know, come on, get real here.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So there are really four different types of wealth. If you think about it, you've got financial wealth, which is your money, right? And then you've got social wealth, which is your status, mm-hmm. keeping up with the Joneses, if you will. Time wealth, which is quality time with loved ones and doing things you love, achieving goals, those types of things. And then, of course, you've got your health wealth. And without your health, you know, you're not going to be able to enjoy the
sure.
things that you want to do. And so, you know, being conscious of all of those things as you create your financial plan, as you get into your 40s and into your 50s and you start thinking about, that's when people really start thinking about what am I going to do with the rest of my life? And it's almost like a light switch goes off or on at age 50 and people are like, okay, I really need to start paying attention to what's going on here.
Yeah. You know, I look at it from a legacy of memories, you know, from the perspective of spending time with your children and your grandchildren and creating those memories, because that's all they're going to have after you pass away, right? I mean, you can have all the money in the world, but if you didn't have the time, what memory did you create? Well, you gave your banker a lot of
right.
things to be thankful for. But outside of that, you know, it really is about people.
Let's go to this first question that I posed, Bud. What is financial wealth? What does it mean to be wealthy? Mm-hmm. And I think if you think about your financial independence, and the definition of financial independence is being able to do the things that you want to do on a daily basis, because what it's what's important to you. If you can do that and you don't have to worry about money, in other words, you've got freedom from worry about money, mm-hmm. you're wealthy.
Right.
Right. Mm-hmm. Because somebody could do it with $500,000. Somebody else may want to feel more comfortable if they had $5 million. It depends on what you want your life to look like and how you want to live.
Yeah, it really comes down to stability. You know, the stability of you to be able to fulfill your life of years, you know, in a situation where you're comfortable, where you're getting happiness out of the situation, and money shouldn't necessarily define that. And for most people, I don't think it necessarily does. However, the worry is always there. But, you know, we're looking at a situation right now with Social Security, right? You know, there's a lot of pressure, you know, on Social Security. When's it going to run out? And my reply to that, and for our audience, Dean, is that it will be taken care of. Otherwise, you'll see the greatest gray army out there kicking out all the congressmen and senators for not doing the right thing. So I'm not overly concerned about that. But I am concerned about people that might be taking Social Security prematurely, not realizing that from a planning perspective, they could actually create that stability by postponing that. But that has to be taken into account in the overarching part of what a full financial plan provides.
Well, and I would say, Bud, that Social Security is part of your wealth.
Oh, without a doubt.
Right? And the reason that I say that is because your entire working life, you put money into the Social Security system, and your employer was forced to make a dollar-for-dollar match. So that really is part of your wealth. Now, it's not wealth that you can go in and cash out in a lump sum, but it's wealth that's going to drive income for you during retirement. And as you pointed out, how and when you claim Social Security can mean the difference of, you know, maybe $100,000 or more of additional income coming over the same life expectancy. So people really need to plan around that part of their wealth.
You know, I can't remember, Dean, and maybe you can help me. Was there a time when Social Security wasn't taxable?
Well, when it was originally formed, it was designed to be a tax-free source of income, but it was under Ronald Reagan, I believe it was the Tax Reform Act of 1987, where they finally decided that they should start taxing Social Security. And so what they did was they said that 50% of your Social Security was going to become taxable if your income was above a certain level. So right. I believe it was at above a $32,000 for a married filing jointly couple in the Tax Reform Act of 1987. And then under the Clinton administration, I forget which tax act it was that brought in the fact that now up to 85% of your Social Security could become taxable. So then a married couple filing jointly could have it. If they had income of over $44,000 per year, then up to 85% of the Social Security became taxable. But Social Security by itself today is still tax-free. So if someone only has Social Security, it is tax-free. If somebody only has Social Security and they only have income coming from a Roth IRA, which of course is tax-free, then your Social Security is also tax-free. So there are ways to make Social Security tax-free. You don't want to talk about a wealth eroder, though. You're bringing something up. One of the biggest wealth eroders out there is taxation.
Yeah, without a doubt. And I would have to think that President Reagan and Congress were understanding that the pressure was only increasing on Social Security. Therefore, to perpetuate it into the future, they needed to make part of it taxable so they have some revenue coming back into the program. That would be my guess on
that. Well, I think the whole thing was that they were saying, look, the part of money that went into Social Security that your employer put in, which is half of it, mm-hmm. has never been taxed. Mm-hmm. And so let's tax that portion as it comes out if your income is above a certain level. That was the general premise of what happened during the Tax Reform Act in 1987.
Exactly right. And when you think about that, now we're starting to inch our way into financial planning, aren't we?
Yeah.
Because now we're going in and saying, well, if there's some way that I can have income that isn't going to impact my Social Security, then most certainly I should direct some of my money in that direction to be able to achieve a net positive benefit out of that.
All right, let's go on, Bud, to talk about social wealth. Mm-hmm. And for a lot of people, this is important. Being able to be part of a social group, a special group. Now, some social wealth doesn't necessarily require money. It's more about camaraderie.
Church.
It's church. It could be things like the Lions Club, the Rotary.
Supporting the local high school.
Yeah.
You know, lots of different things.
There is that social wealth. It's being with people that are of like mind, mm-hmm. with, you know, similar missions and goals in life.
Yeah. It's interesting over all these years, you know, that I have a group of clients, actually, I'll say several subgroups of my client base that live in proximity of each other. They found out that they were using our firm as well, you know, for their planning and their taxes and, you know, things like that. And the next thing they know, they're getting together for dinner and now they're doing dinner rotations and all this kind of stuff. And we see that element coming true because when we had a Christmas party, as an example, all of a sudden there's one table over there clustered with all the people that never knew each other before they became clients of ours.
And now they're friends.
And now
they got a social group that they can do things with.
Exactly right.
I have an interesting story about social wealth, and this will also tie into time wealth. So had to attend a funeral of...
Recently.
Yeah, recently. Yeah. Recently. This gentleman was very, very, very into the social wealth. Well, his idea of social wealth was time on the golf course with his friends. Mm-hmm. And there was a group of guys that I got to know that would every single year, they'd take a 2-week road trip and drive up into northern Michigan in the summertime, and they would play 36 holes of golf a day. And it was just, it was all about social. Now they drove because it was less expensive. They gathered coupons so that they could play the courses that discount. They wanted to play. So it wasn't like they're doing these elite type of things or doing something that costs a lot of money. But from a social perspective, it was something that brought richness to his life and to the life of the gentleman that he would travel with. And at his funeral, I saw a lot of those guys there. And, you know, for the last 3 or 4 years, he had developed COPD, and so he wasn't able to get out on the course and do the things that he wanted to do. But he took the time early in retirement to figure out what was really important to him, and social wealth to him was something that was super important. And if you think about that, when you're working, your social life tends to be tied to a lot of times the people that you work with because you're like-minded, et cetera.
And I'll add to that, that many times the ladies are the ones that really are the juggernauts, if you will, to get those relationships established. I tell you that because recently one of our clients' husbands passed away. This is wonderful, wonderful couple, great history. And after that, you know, now she's on her own. You know, she had the social network of very close friends. By the way, they're all clients of ours. And in the process of that, though, they came together. They coalesced, you know, to be able to support her when she needed the support the most. And as we go forward, just because she lost her husband doesn't mean she's going to be excluded from those activities. Just the opposite. They're embracing, making sure that they keep that social fiber in place to be able to support the needs of the group.
Yeah. Well, you know, we as humans, we need that social interaction. Oh,
absolutely.
You know, big time. So social wealth is a big one. Time wealth, boy, you know, we did a show that was all about time, you know, our scarcest commodity out there. It's one thing that we're all granted the same amount of on a daily basis, but nobody's guaranteed tomorrow is going to be here. And so, you know, taking the time to truly enjoy and do the things that you want to do and take advantage of every moment is critical.
Yeah, I know with my family and everything, because I played soccer, I coached soccer with my children that are in their 40s at this particular point. They're now coaching soccer and everything else, and I try to get to the games, but I have to tell you, they play so many games. I would not have a life. My wife and I would not, if we went to all of them. So we kind of have to pick and choose from time to time.
Yeah.
But
well, how many grandkids are there that you're trying to get?
Just four at this point. So, but we've got probably more, in the works.
Yeah, but still, that's, I mean, you get four young kids out there that are, you can't possibly take the time to go to every single game.
No, and dashing in between different locations, et cetera, et cetera. So
yeah, I think time wealth is a big one. And when I think of time wealth, I think about not waiting too long to do the things that you want to do. I see people far too often that will put off things too long when in reality, they may be 5 years out from retirement, and we can show them that even if they didn't save another dollar between now and the time of retirement, they're going to be in good shape if that's the point at which they want to retire. So take the money that you have been saving and start doing some of the things that you want to do later in life. Start doing those today. Don't put it off.
Yeah. I even go to the point of 13 months ago, my mother passed away at the age of 94. And in the time not spent, if you will, you know, with her because she was in a different location and everything, and the guilt associated with it. Gosh, I should be down with mom at this particular point in time. But we've all had those struggles, you know, we do the best we can with it. And fortunately, I think most people understand.
Well, and then that leads right into, Bud, the health wealth, right? If you got to have health, right, you've got to take care of yourself. You've got to go to regular checkups, go to the doctor, you know, make sure that you're doing preventative care, exercise, eat right. And those things are totally in your control. They're not easy, you know.
Well, there's no reward for it if it was easy, right?
Yeah, not easy. But yeah, without your health, you know, you can have all the money in the world and it doesn't really matter. Had a client passed away last year, and really this ties into money. It ties into time. It ties into social, and it ties into health. Now this individual passed away. He had had a kidney transplant probably 8 years prior, and his wife had breast cancer. We're talking, and they had plenty of money to do whatever they wanted to do. And all she wanted to do, this was her, was spend the winters someplace warm and spend the winters in Florida. That's where she really wanted to go. Mm-hmm. And it took him a lot to say, okay, Dean, you've shown me from a financial perspective that I can do it. And it took a lot for him to spend the money to do that. But when I told him, I said, you've got to look at the reality. You had a kidney transplant. You've got 10 years at the most. Mm-hmm. So let's think about the time here. Don't think about the money piece of it. I can show you from a financial perspective how you can afford it, but think about the time.
Yeah.
Right. So they began to do that, and they did it for about 4 years until his health eroded to a point where they just couldn't do it anymore, but at least they did it.
Right.
But they had a good social network. They had the social wealth as well that had nothing to do with the financial wealth that they had. And so, you know, now, you know, the lady, she's got people, you know, come and pick her up for church. Let's go to dinner. Let's go do these things. Join us with, you know, when we're going out to do these. And it was all really, really well put together. But had we not taken the time to complete the plan and for them to actually see that from a financial perspective, they had the freedom from financial worry to do the things that they wanted to do, to spend the time and do the things that they wanted, I'm afraid that they wouldn't have done it.
Yeah, you're probably right. But, you know, another element of this on this social is technology, because we meet probably 30% of our client base. We meet online through Zoom, you know, and it's beautiful. They can see me, I can see them, and so on and so forth. And it really turns out to be as meaningful a meeting as if they were in office, you know, doing it that way. So thank goodness for that. When you come back to the social element of that, it was, I think, 2 years ago that my wife and I decided that we were going to have all my sons and grandchildren Zoom in on us, and then we had a quiz on Disney. You know, so we
I remember that. That was during COVID.
Yeah, was that COVID? Yeah,
I guess it would have been. I remember when you did that.
So we did that, and we had a ball, you know, and everybody said, this is so cool to do something like this and get everybody together. You're right, it was COVID.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, so, and I think, you know, while the pandemic hurt in a lot of ways, it did actually advance technology and brought people together socially in a way that they didn't think that they could get together before. Right. And from a time perspective, Bud, you know, we're seeing the same thing. A lot of our clients, though, maybe they want to come in and visit in person if it's convenient, But they've now gotten to a point where, hey, we can visit through Zoom. We can have this relationship and think about the social aspect with kids and with grandkids and being able to see those kids grow up and sharing of the instant videos and those types of things.
Yeah, how'd you do in your game today? Well, let me show you. Yeah. And in fact, they'll have a video on their phone that they'll say we can see what's going on with that. So a lot of good things. Think of all the sadness, though, going back to the COVID for the people that weren't permitted to be able to go to their loved ones.
Oh, yeah.
That just breaks my heart when I think about that.
Yeah, you know, and what we're really talking about today is wealth.
Yeah.
Right? And wealth can be defined in many ways by many people, but I would say this, that true wealth is defined by things that money can't buy and that death can't take away.
I like that.
And if you think about that, you know, it's all about your life, right? It's your legacy should be a living legacy. It should be the memories and the experiences and all of that. You know, a lot of people are tied up with, I want to leave a legacy for my grandkids. I want to leave a legacy for my kids. And if they're thinking from a financial standpoint, they need to have a meaningful conversation with those kids and with those grandkids and say, what would you rather have? Time with us. We can pay for some trips. We can get together each year in a setting that is somewhere where everybody want to go, and we can spend our money that way, or we can leave a pile of money behind for you guys. Which would you rather do? And I will tell you, because I've experienced it, most of the time it's like, no, let's go do some stuff. Let's be together.
Well, life is finite. You know, we just don't know that finishing date, if you will. Yeah. So, I think everything we've talked about here resonates with people, and it's important.
Right. Well, and it's all about having the confidence and the freedom and the time. But if you don't have the confidence that you can do the things that you want to do and you have freedom from financial worry, the time part of it's going to slip away from you, because you're not going to be comfortable enough knowing that, oh, I can stop working now, or, oh, I can take that vacation, or, oh, I can help that grandchild get a new vehicle when they graduate college, or so many things that are on people's minds that they really want to do. But that's what financial planning does. And that, Bud, I believe is the biggest reward that you and I get on a daily basis, is seeing the change in people's lives that real financial planning brings.
I so totally agree, Dean.
We appreciate you joining us here on America's Wealth Management Show. I'm Dean Barber along with Bud Kasper. We hope we've helped you really think a little bit about what is wealth and what does it mean to you. We'll be back with you next week, same time, same place. Everybody stay healthy and stay safe.
Views expressed represent the opinion of Modern Wealth Management, LLC, an SEC-registered investment advisor. Information provided is for illustrative purposes only and does not constitute investment, tax, or legal advice. Modern Wealth Management does not accept any liability for the use of the information discussed. Consult with a qualified financial, legal, or tax professional prior to taking any action.